Good morning and God bless you. We're delighted to have you with us here this morning. Maybe this is your first time tuning in and joining us. We extend a warm welcome to you and trust that you're blessed today. We want to begin with prayer. We want to pray about the condition of our nation in our world. We want to continue to pray also for a great door of utterance and influence to not just open up here in Spokane, but wherever you are. Maybe you're watching this and you're wherever you attend, pray that God will open up a great door of utterance and influence for your congregation. We also want to pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church here locally, and then our brothers and sisters around the world. Maybe you have a special unspoken request. It's a perfect time to make that known unto God. Let's pray together. Father, we love you, we praise you, and we worship you. Father, we thank you for calling us out of darkness and bringing us into this marvelous light. Father, we pray about the condition and the direction of our nation and our world. God, we pray for a great Holy Ghost revival. Father, we also pray for a great and effectual door of utterance and influence to open up here in Spokane, Washington, for the work of God to go forward. We also pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church. Pray that you'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out your favor upon us locally. And then lastly, our brothers and sisters around the globe, that you would furnish each and every one of them with a hedge of protection. We ask all these things in the name above every name, the name of Jesus. And everybody said, Amen. Well, I want to draw your attention here to the book of Philippians, a familiar passage to us, but an incredible passage of Scripture. Philippians chapter number 3, and begin reading in verse number 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. I have not arrived. I have not laid hold of everything that I want for my life. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Dealing with regret. Dealing with regret. Now, brothers and sisters, or as some of our young kids here love it when I say, ladies and gentlemen, we all have regrets. I believe that it is one of the foibles of living this life. Even though we're in the church of the living God, and even though we have experienced this glorious new birth, and even though we have received great and exceeding precious promises, and we have been partakers of the divine nature, etc., etc., even though we have the incredible divine resource of the baptism of the Holy Ghost in our lives and the Word of God and all that we have, whether you're in the church, out of the church, we are going to all experience regrets. And I really believe that, I know that this is true in in my case. It may not be true in your case, although I do really believe that everybody that's watching this does have regrets. I believe that when you get a little bit older, that some of these regrets become a little bit more defined because you see the evidences of things. The Bible says that wisdom is justified of her children. Well, there's other things that become more, that have more clarity as time goes on because they just become more pronounced through time. A decision that was made, or we took this direction, or we did this, I said this, whatever the situation may be. But I really do believe that even though, as we all get older, that we all have regrets and we all think about our regrets, that I also believe that we are able to look at our regrets in a more balanced and reasonable way. Let me explain what I'm talking about. Oftentimes when people have regrets, we're talking about even people that are living under condemnation and shame over some hideous thing or some choice, some decision, a moment of weakness maybe. Anything really, a situation where that was made compulsively or not prayed about, not thought about, just I'm going to do this, da 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 da, and that person lives under the shadow of that. Although that is a regret that is quickly dismissed by the blood of Jesus Christ, that those kinds of things, I don't think we'll completely do away with those in our mind because we all have a memory. But those serve as opportunities for learning. Even the most hideous of things, Mr. or Mrs. Prodigal, we can all learn from those. But I'm just talking about in a general sense. As we get older, we begin to review things. We begin to see the evidences of our decisions and our choices as they continue to mature and grow. And we review our regrets. We have to keep those in check. And as I've already mentioned, I think one of the most mature and godly ways of looking at our regrets is to look at them as opportunities, educational opportunities. But we all have regrets. You're never going to be able to get away with it. But I will say this about regrets, even though it is a fact of life, I think it is unhealthy to allow your regrets to get in the way of pursuing what is before you. And I really believe that the apostle, at least in part, did the apostle Paul have regrets? Here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't think you could find a better subject, except maybe for the apostle Peter would be right there with him. But the apostle Paul had regrets. He talks about these things. But I believe that Philippians chapter 3 most accurately and adequately addresses this, puts it in its place, and now, okay, let's deal with really what we need to deal with. And I couldn't say it any better than what the apostle says when he says this right here. He says, but this one thing I do. Because your regrets can eat your lunch if you let them. It's like if you don't keep it, if you don't keep your regrets where they need to be, and I really believe that if you're going to be, if you're going to be either a great leader, or you're going to become a great saint, or you are a great saint, or you're moving towards that place of finding your maturation, your maturity, and coming into full age of what God has for you. Whether you're a pastor, evangelist, good saint of God, board member, usher, whatever it is, wherever you are, all of us have got to learn to compartmentalize. What that means is that you are able to put things in its proper slot. And it's more than that. Compartmentalization means that you not only put things in its slot, but you don't give it any more mental or emotional power and gravity that it's worth. Okay? This is a learning thing for some people. Some people think, I've got this situation and it just, it has all power, it has all influence, and they're a mess for a while. I get that. But through time, you're able to get this thing into its cage and close the door and learn, okay, I'm not going to let you out because you devour everything, you influence everything. It's unhealthy to let you out. So I'm just going to regret that right now. And I'm even going to monitor how much time I spend on that. Why? Because I need to put that behind me, like the Apostle Paul said, and now deal with what's really important, my future. So compartmentalization is, it's an extremely important faculty that all you and I all possess. And that is putting things in its proper place and allowing it or affording it really, really what it's worth. If it's not worth worrying about, okay, you're there, not a big deal. But any person that has become a great leader has learned to compartmentalize because you have things you got to deal with, you have responsibilities you have to face, you have situations that have to be dealt with, but you don't overly emote, you don't overly think, you don't overly give it any more of your attention than you have to. You just deal with it and move on. But I really believe that the Apostle Paul is saying, putting those things behind me. Regrets. And we know that the Apostle Paul dealt with this because there's other places in Scripture where he is fully aware of the damage that he did before he had all of the understanding and all the supernatural experience that he needed. This one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. My opinion about this is I don't believe that he was able to totally forget, but he was putting it in its place. Because none of us can really forget. However, we can compartmentalize it and put it in its proper place, which is part of a much bigger panorama. Listen, your life is not defined by a regret or a series of regrets. Your life is not defined by a paragraph in a chapter. It's not defined by a chapter in a book. And all of us have this incredible resource of being able to change. But I strongly recommend that we deal with regrets once and for all. Now, I have met people that become paralyzed by their regrets. Like they And I really believe it's more than just this devotional this morning. I believe there's more to it than that. When a person becomes so consumed that they are now immobilized, they are paralyzed, they cannot believe the word of God, they cannot experience hope, trust, faith, and I know that people need to move through trauma, whether it's self-induced or otherwise. But at some point, it needs to become, okay, that sentence was a regret. That paragraph was a regret. That chapter was a regret. Never going to do that again. And let's put that in its proper place and let's move forward. The Apostle Paul was the most qualified person to be able to identify with us, being a persecutor of the church of the living God, tearing apart families and saints and people that he would one day see in heaven. And he lived with those regrets. But he's saying, you know what? I'm not even going to focus on this anymore. I'm going to forget about this because I've got something far more important, far more wonderful, far more purposeful, and far more part of my responsibility. And that's my future. And so what I'm going to do is forget those things which are behind. And with all my focus, all my strength, all my heart, all my mind, and all my ability, I'm going to reach for those things that are before. You can do it. If the Apostle Paul can do it, you and I can do this. Putting regrets in their place. God bless you. Thank you for joining us here this morning. We'll look forward to seeing you tomorrow.